Good afternoon, everyone. I'm presenting a paper on a retrospective study of Cage subsidence in OLIF patients. Cage subsidence is a common complication in OLIF surgery, which can lead to recurrence of clinical symptoms. There are multiple studies published which have noted Cage subsidence, like this one, which has 18% subsidence, another one, which has 12.2% of clinical recurrence due to 14.3% incidence of Cage subsidence, and one more, which has 22% of Cage subsidence. The principle of OLIF is on indirect decompression of the spinal canal by jacking up of the disc space. The causative factors of cage subsidence are cage size, which includes cage height and cage width, per-operative end plate damage, and osteoporosis. The aims and objectives of the study are to establish a correlation between percentage of disc height increased by selection of appropriate cage height with cage subsidence, correlation of cage width in relation to end plate width and cage subsidence, per operative end plate damage and cage subsidence. This was a retrospective study of 35 patients, which involved 48 OLIF segments. The inclusion criteria was minimum of 6 months follow-up and post-operative MRI scan. The exclusion criteria was less than 6 months follow-up and inadequate X-rays and MRI scans. The evaluation was based on X-rays and MRIs. X-rays for cage subsidence and disc height increase, whereas end plate width and cage width were measured on the axial sections of the MRI scan. Clinical evaluation was done on MacNab grading. The results, we had 9 males and 26 female patients with an average age of 62.6 years and a follow-up ranging from 6 months to 2 years. We had 7 segments of lytic listhesis, 34 of degenerative listhesis, and 7 of adjacent segment disease. The respective segments and their average cage height and width have been mentioned here, which says L12, we had 2 segments, L23, we have 5 segments, L34 has 13, and the maximum were of L45, which had 28 segments. We had 23 cases of one level, 11 of two levels, and one of three level OLIF fixation. On MacNab grading, we had 71% of excellent results and 28.57% of good results. The rate of cage subsidence was 25%. The average disc height increase was 32.58%. Average cage width was 12.22% smaller than ideal, and it had no correlation with cage subsidence. There was per-operative end plate damage in 12.5% of the cases, and it has maximum correlation with cage subsidence. Although we had 25% cage subsidence, none of the patients had clinical symptoms, nor they required resurgery. Now, the first case is of 52-year-old female. And this is the pre-operative X-ray, the immediate post-operative X-ray, a 1 year follow-up X-ray, and the post-operative MRI. As we can see here, there is no subsidence present. The second case of a 75-year-old male patient, and this is a pre-operative image. This was a two-level OLIF. Per-operative, we can see the end plate damage in the images, and the 1 year follow-up, which also shows the cage subsidence because of the per-operative end plate damage. And even though there is cage subsidence, there are no clinical symptoms. A 62-year-old female with low back pain is a pre-operative X-ray, the immediate post-op X-ray, which is fine, and a 1 year follow-up, which shows cage subsidence. And even though there is cage subsidence, there are no clinical complaints. The limitations of study were, this is a retrospective study of small size. We could not have a quantitative analysis of osteoporosis. The follow-up is short, and there is no statistical analysis done for the same. So in conclusion, there is no correlation between cage height and cage size to cage subsidence in our study. Per-operative end plate damage is a major contributing factor for cage subsidence. And even though there is cage subsidence, there is no clinical correlation in our study. Thank you.